of the growth strategy for staffing companies. On one hand, we saw a lot of interesting data about the growth, 22% year on year. We're looking at about 6 million people entering the tech workforce in the private space in the next 1 to 2 years. A lot of new legislations which are going to help the industry per se. On the other hand, we also have some question marks about business models, newly set up organizations. And our objective today is to give the audience takeaways on what are some of those points that we need to keep in mind. So I'm going to start with Alok. Alok, you know, most of the staffing organizations are servicing customers in sectors like technology, engineering, logistics, supply chain, and in roles like sales, IT, you know, accounts. Now, these are all, you know, known sectors for us. What can you share with the audience, the sectors of tomorrow? What should newly set up or evolving organizations keep in mind for the future?
So we all know some of the sunrise sectors that we have been talking about, and we have seen that in reports of ISF also, that e-commerce and retail or logistics, they are the main drivers of the economy. But what we forget, and we are probably as an industry, we are not prepared to source those kind of profiles or to help those kind of clients. So I think that some of the new sectors which we have to really target are some of the sectors like these, like truck drivers, maybe one of those areas, like media and entertainment areas, like pharma and healthcare, manufacturing, machinery, non-machinery. These are some of the sectors which probably as a sector we have to provide our expertise to the corporates. And one thing which we need to keep in mind, that we are not in business of providing jobs to people. We are in business of providing people to the jobs. So once we change our mindset that we have to find the right people for the right job, and then irrespective of sectors, focusing on the some of the sectors wherein they actually the client needs our expertise, so it will be a good growth strategy for all of us. Secondly, it's a being in service industry, it's a one of the really one of the worst things, that the when we become a commodity. So that's something we have to avoid. Once we become the commodity, the only thing we need to compete, we all come down to competing on the pricing, and it's a, with the razor thin pricing, then we tend to compromise on quality, on deliverables. So we have to keep focusing on innovating ourselves and adopting the best practices, learn from each other, and giving our clients the value add.
So I'm just going to, you know, put this to Mr. Muralidharan. Even in the morning, there were a couple of gentlemen from the logistics sector who said, hey, we want to hire 500,000 drivers. And my observation, and you know, correct me if I'm wrong, is a lot of us in the staffing sector usually shy away from this. What's your reading? What is the reason? Because there seems to be a big opportunity. There is a pain at our customer's end, but somewhere we're not able to capitalize on that. What's happening?
Very briefly, our company does about 25,000-30,000 permanent hires per year. We train skill development about 40,000-45,000 people a year. And our staffing business is very small. So what I'm going to say, maybe against some of your beliefs, fundamentally, the biggest mistake we are doing in staffing industry is that we are not looking at the candidate end of the business. The reason why we have been demoted in the candidate's mind is because it is positioned in India as a cost reduction exercise. So the employer pays some salary to his employees, and he pays less employees to staffing employees, which is not the model in which IT industry started. It was meant on design on flexibility. You have a shorter duration, and therefore you don't get benefits and so on. So the first problem is, for example, drivers. They've been talking to us in large numbers. We work with all the e-commerce companies. My only question to you is that, okay, fine, I'm willing to hire 10,000 people. What's in it for them? If a driver travels, now recently there's a lot of innovation has come where drivers travel short distances. But if you look at truck drivers, their family life used to be ruined. And they used to travel long distances, all kind of habits. So basically, fundamental point is, first candidate standpoint, is it viable, economically viable for him to do that job? The second, I think, is important is, how does employers see us as a staffing industry? Are they seeing and commoditizing, like you said, on cost, or they see us as a value-creating entity? If you want value-creating entity, it's a two-way process. We need to start believing that we are going to deliver value. And the employer has to start coming to the negotiating table to say that, okay, if you deliver value, how do I compensate you? For example, one example I'll give you before I wind up, because everybody has to speak. We are working with one of the Axis Bank Group companies, and Quest is the partner for the staffing side, and we are the training partner. Every month, we are on the training model. We publish or work on productivity versus retention data of the entire cohorts. Unless there is a clear movement on both fronts, retention or what we call residency has to go up, and at the same time your productivity has gone up. Today companies don't share data with us. We had to struggle for 1 year to get the data from them, because they said, no, we also have good staffing, we are quite capable of analyzing our own data, unless we projected some of them. And one interesting point in the analytics which really blew them apart was that when you do a 6-quadrant matrix of dimension, one side is residency. Residency means how long the guy stays in the system, and productivity. One quadrant what? High residency and low productivity. And there are a large number of people in that quadrant. So I was asking the company, I mean, you claim you have a performance management system. How come you have a large number of people? And many of them are in staffing roles. Right. So this is what is important. I think we need to change our narrative. We need to start talking to customers. First, believe in ourselves. How do we create value? Compliance is important. It is still important. But compliance is not enough for us to get a higher margin in this business. Thank you.
Thank you. And, you know, appreciate your very from the heart and candid. And that's exactly what we want to hear. On that, I'm going to, you know, take it as a segue, Tarang. Sourcing is a topic that I know is very close to your heart. You're very passionate about it when we discussed it last week as well. Whether it's drivers or whether it's technology staff, you know, while on one hand we have the whole 1.4 billion and, you know, X million which is entering the labor force, but then sourcing is a challenge for our customers, for us. It'll be great for us to hear, you know, what are some of the best practices, what is your perspective, and, you know, how can we capitalize on the supply in India, and what are you doing something different from a sourcing perspective?
Yes, so as you are aware, for any staffing company, sourcing is one of the key role which we have to deliver to our customer. Now, there are some most important challenge in sourcing is when we are working as a staffing company, that we are getting number of different type of skill sets, and we are working with different segments of industry. Now, when we are addressing different skill sets and when we are addressing different segments of the company, different sectors of industries, every skill set and segment require different strategy to source people. You can't implement the same strategy with the different segment. Now, we are talking about drivers. Now, most of the staffing companies will be very excited in hiring those drivers. They may come and say, okay, why don't you give us the chance to employ these drivers? But again, when we are giving it to our recruiters who are actually at the field or at our office to source these kind of skill sets, it is a different thing for them. So we need to have a strategy for each different position and for each different segment. I'll give you an example. As a company, we are working in very extreme areas. At one point, we are hiring IT professionals, and at one time, we are hiring blue-collar people who are into construction industries. Now, you cannot implement the same sourcing strategy to hire a person who is a professional, who is an IT contractor. Okay, there we have a different strategy, we have a different set of people who are working towards that. They have a different set of mindset. The way of talking to those people are totally different. The techniques of talking to them and identifying them and delivering to customers are totally different. Whereas if we are talking to, when we are doing sourcing for blue collar, I'll give you an example. When we started working with one of the very big infrastructure company, they require fabricators, welders for one of their infrastructure projects. And we were already dealing with the, we were dealing in this kind of skill set with many manufacturing companies. And we were very confident that we can deliver them 200, 300 people within a short span of 15 days because we are already dealing with this kind of skill set. But try to understand, the skill sets were almost same, but the industry was different and we were failed to deliver even 10 people in next 15 days. And after that we learned that getting these kind of people, the same strategy will not work. So we find out with the hard way that these people comes from in groups, they are having a different channel to bring those kind of people. So in sourcing, you should have a appropriate strategy for each skill set and for each segment. My advice to our staffing companies is it's time you build your competency in specific segments instead of being generalistic in all the segments. Because this strategy will not work in all the segments, same strategies. It's mine.
Yeah, so Tarang, I just want to further dwell on that. And I'm just being very honest because it happens in all companies, including ours. And because I started as a recruiter 20 years ago, and maybe that's one of the reasons it's a bad habit, I keep comparing. So when we did hiring earlier, of course, it was pre-social media. So, you know, we networked, we referenced, we spoke to people, and we checked who's got a good track record. So do you feel somewhere social media has spoiled our recruiters and they take the easy way out and ultimately both customer and the agency suffers? What's your opinion?
In my opinion, I'm not fully say that social media is spoiling it, but it is giving convenience to our people because of which they are becoming slightly lazy in going into field and, you know, approaching people directly. They try to get it by sitting within the office space and trying to connect people, which sometimes doesn't work in certain specific industries. For certain specific industry, it works well. If you are talking about retail and talking about those kind of segments, this networking, social media, it works. But when we are talking about, when we are going for blue collar job, there people are not aware about all this kind of thing. You have to go on the ground, you have to talk to them, you have to connect them, different sources, you have to reach to them, and then only you will get those kind of people.
Our company does a huge amount of sourcing. On permanent hire, about 2.5 lakh people we meet. I think the key to sourcing is to go back to my first point, what's in it for him, right? So, like you said, strategy being different. Our experience in sourcing has been that people think getting a contact is sourcing. Actually, sourcing begins from there. Getting to him to an interview, getting to an offer stage, each of this requires a different level and different type of communication. Because it is not like buying a Coke bottle, having a drink Coke and going home. For the individual, taking a job is a big decision. And social media may be very good in buying, because you're buying something one time, you're spending some money. The investment you make is 100 bucks, 200 rupees. Here, invest your part of your life. So the decision the individual makes on choosing an employer or a job is a much higher order decision. And therefore, any of these media can only open up the door. There's still the selling has to happen.
I also want to go back to one point that you made, which I thought was very important, is looking at things from the candidate's perspective. This is usually something that we take for granted. Of course, the client is important, the client pays our bills. But, you know, the whole candidate experience, looking at it from the candidate's life cycle, I think that's something that some of us miss. And people who get it right, who are able to crack that code, will really reap the benefits. You know, moving on, I want to, you know, ask Mr. Bhargav, you know, a different kind of question. So I was reading this book last week. It was on the 1965 war, because my dad used to be in the army many years ago. And I found a very interesting quote which said, "What's a strategy if everything comes according to plan?" So I didn't understand it the first few seconds. I'm like, okay, am I not understanding? What is this? And I asked my dad, because he used to be in the army. I said, what does this mean? So then he explained, he said, no, what they're trying to say is in the army, you have to be prepared that whatever plan you put together, things are not going to go according to plan. You may be on a mountaintop, it's like Kargil, what happened, right? I mean, you never it's difficult, you know, your enemy is right on top. So the perspective, Mr. Bhargav, what would be great for you to give us is the revenue models for the future. Today, a lot of organizations, including the large companies like Randstad or all the others, you know, we've got certain business models in place which are global, national. We've got these cost optimization models. But, you know, obviously, you know, things keep changing, especially in this part of the world. What are your thoughts, insights for organizations, especially who are evolving? What are some of those business models of the future that we need to keep in mind, which will change the way this industry functions?
Thanks, Sanjay. First, let's understand all of us are in staffing business, and unfortunately, we are into a business which does not offer very huge margins. I think that's something which everyone here will agree with me. So maybe in terms of percentage, we work on certain 4%, 5%, 6% margin, nothing beyond that. But if you look at the whole situation, when I raise a bill on a customer, I raise a bill of, say, if my charges are 5% and 100% is my staffing cost, staff people, salaries, I raise a bill of 105 rupees. Now, moment I do that, the TDS gets deducted on 105 and not on what my margins are. So the first challenge as an industry what we face is a cash flow problem as to how do we manage our cash flows, because the whole TDS gets deducted on the whole amount, and besides that we are supposed to pay GST, which is 18%. So just imagine, you work on a margin of 5%, but 18% is your cash outflow more just because you need to pay to the government first. So this is the scenario in which we are working. When you look at the funding models, as to what are the funding options available, and I've talked to a lot of staffing companies, and if at all they are availing facilities, they are availing book debts against you know, the outstanding. So that is the facility which they are availing. According to me, even that is a very wrong model. Because when you take book debts, you get funded only to the extent of 75% of your book debts. You know, that is maximum a customer bank may agree is about 80% funding. So this means whenever you do business, whenever you increase your business, every time you will have to shell out 20% from your pocket, from your internal sources, which that money has to be generated. So if that being the scenario where for every business, and for all of us, we know that staffing is a volume business. So the volumes increase very fast and our funding problem, you know, increases. So the best way, you know, which I tell people is never to go for a facility which is book debts, go for a bill discounting facility. The reason when I say bill discounting, firstly, you get 100% funding. So if you have raised a bill of 118 rupees, you get 118 rupees from the bank so that you don't invest your money. The other advantages are there, that when you're doing a bill discounting facility, the banks do a credit check on the customer. So you also come to know about the history of the customer, whereas again, book debts, you don't get that. You don't have the luxury of bank checking the status of the customer. The third biggest advantage is when it's a bill discounting, banks have to have first recourse against the customer. So if payment has not been made, the first recourse is from the customer, and if he fails to pay, then the recourse is to you. So in a way, if you look at it, bill discounting is a facility where we can manage our funds flow. Because I've talked to many staffing companies, many people from the staffing companies, that this is the way to go about of having a bill discounting and not book debts facility. So this is as regarding the funding is concerned. Secondly, as I would always say, you know, we talked about uncertainty and all that. It's always important to have budgets. Because if you have budgets, what you try to do is you try to bring you know, uncertainties into certainties. So budget is something which I would suggest all staffing companies should get to an exercise of preparing budgets for the whole year, because that would help you to not only just plan what is going to be your sales, but it will also help you to plan what is going to be your back office. It will help you to plan your finances. So that is something, second thing, which I would suggest.
Thank you. So Muridharan, technology, you know, we've been speaking about it the whole day. Of course, that's something that, you know, gets into every conversation. So when you look at the business models for the future, when you look at cost optimization, what's the role, and if you can tell us very clearly, anything specific that technology is going to play, and what should we be wary of, and what should we keep in mind?
See, one of the clear measure of the future of work is going to be, apart from repetitive tasking, rule-based decision-making jobs will go. This is really on the hit list. And I think all McKinsey report, all of them support the same theory. But if you look at bulk of our volume of business, either in data management, data sourcing, data analytics, or some kind of rule-based decision-making, call center, for example, is a rule-based decision-making. So technology is going to impact the kind of job roles on which you'll be working on. That's the first thing we have to accept. The same job roles we are doing there may not be exist tomorrow. Second one, everybody has put a lot of, we meet a lot of people who put a lot of bots. We do RPA right now. So the transaction, now today morning also there's a lot of talk about digitization means transaction management, large scale transaction management. Transaction means bot. The transactions are going to go completely out of the human list because they can do it faster, they can do it better, they don't do error free. So the technology role is going to be the transaction based job roles again will vanish. The third thing which people always talk about, how can technology help in recruiting people? And today they talk about pre-assessment, all kind of algorithms are being used. My personal take on it, that can only filter to the first stage of the recruitment process. For example, if I have a large kind of database, I can do some auto call drops, various kind of technologies to get people who are looking for a job. That's it. Today you don't know, when you get a job board database, you don't know whether you're looking for a job, for me to even pitch. So that first stage, technology will help. Thereafter, human interface is absolutely essential to take that guy step by step by step to a conclusion. So technology, I still say, will take a long time in recruiting. And the last portion about more than technology, I think we are going to be in an era of measurement. Like if we talk about devices, I think today somebody has talked about it. So performance measurement, every stage, attendance measurement every day. Like for example, we get today some of our customers, we know daily attendance before the customer knows, based on the technology we adopt. So we know the guy is coming to work. And we found out in one case of one customer, if somebody doesn't come to work for 3 days consecutively, he's likely to abscond. So some analytics showed us that, and therefore then we started calling the candidate on the second day itself to ask him, are you planning to come tomorrow? Are you looking for a job? Tell us now. So we look for somebody replacement. So measurement and analytics of technology is extremely going to come collateral to our business. So 3 points, yeah.
Would you recommend build or buy technology? Would you recommend building it on your own, or would you recommend buying it? What is your?
I'm a big fan of Zoho. I think that here we TMI has used Zoho in the past. I think we have tried. I've done applicant tracking system 3 times. All the 3 times I failed, because you quickly realize at some point of time it's a specialty. The most difficult part of technology development is usability, where we all go wrong. We know the functionality. We have all the theories of how it can be done, but at the end of the day, user is not excited even to sit in front of the machine. So, to my mind, don't build anything. Try and see what is available. See, there are APIs are available now. API is a way of communicating between one software and another software. So, you could have a good team in your office to maintain, understand the software. You a lot of change management you need to do in the company. But as much as possible, I've learned after spending 10, 12 crores of money, it's better to buy.
Thank you. You know, so innovation is a word that's used, again, I heard it a couple of times during the day. Mr. Kulkarni, you're doing something very innovative on the sourcing aspect. You know, the whole learn while you earn. I think it's not just a catchphrase, but something very important in today's time. It'd be great for you to share with us What are some of the things that you're doing, and how is it going to impact the workforce of the future? Because that's really what we are looking at.
Thank you very much. Good afternoon to all. Sourcing is one of the biggest challenges in staffing industry. I think everybody knows it. So what we have done that we have, basically we work more on the blue collar compared to the white collar. So what we have done that we have identified the job roles, maybe 10 pass, 12 pass ITI. We took the student from the remote area where they do not have the opportunity for further education, socio-economic background. We put them in the industry. It is a sort of a German dual education model, customized in Indian aspect. So we have put these students on the in the industry. They work for 8 hours regularly. Then we impart the education model, classroom training inside the factory premises. Typically in our education system, student goes to the colleges. Here the faculty goes to the industry, a something different model. And then the, we have a 2 hours of classroom training dedicatedly daily for the student. On the weekly off, we take them to nearby colleges for the practicals. We have the programs of diploma mechanical, diploma electrical, diploma hospitality, diploma in pharmacy, diploma in food science, various diplomas. And tell me, I'll tell you, industry bears the entire cost of the education. The minimum stipend paid to the student is 10,000 rupees. The university conducts the exam. It is a very, very tailor-made model. The people who have a first and second shift, they appear in the exam for the evening. Those who have a third shift, second shift, they appear in the morning. So the exams are conducted by the university. Affiliation is given by State Board of Technical Education. Entire expenses is borne by the industry. The student who have never dreamt that they can become in something in their life, more than 18,000 students became engineer, got the permanent placement in the various industries. It not only developed their life, it has really given the talent which industry requires. On the job training, along with the formal education, as a staffing industry, Yashasvi there for more than 3 decades, the things are changing. We need to change the kind of a margins which earlier we used to have. I think everybody is aware that it has been reduced like anything. To sustain that, the issue of, sir said that TDS, issue of GST, you go to the bank, take the facility, bank facility, the interest which so much that your margins will 100% go there. You will left with nothing, even you go with the volume. The time has really come because of internal competition, what we people do in the industry, this situation has come. I personally feel that unless we have a training given to these kind of students, this kind of a temp staffing, whether it is a blue collar, whether it is a white collar, we cannot able to sustain. The moment you start providing the training, I have an experience, industry pay for that, because that is a second line development for them. You can use the industry, you can request them to use the CSR funding. We have a typical pharmaceutical skilling model which we do in Goa with the companies like Cipla, Cadila, Lupin, Dr. Reddy's, Microlab. They have funded through their CSR to establish the skill development lab in the Goa. We have a 3 months residential training for the students. Right, start from the morning yoga, the classroom session. In the evening we have the sports, weekly industrial visit. Some of the senior people of all these companies, they visit Goa one day. They spend whole day time with these students. After 3 months, they go to the respective industry for 3 months of on-the-job training. After 6 months, we have the assessment of Life Science Sector Development Council. And those who are passed in that, they have been taken either off-roll or on-roll. Entire expenses borne by the industry through their CSR, not a single pay from the students. I think this is the model, this kind of a model need to be replicated and need to be focused. Industry should spend for their own skill development of their own people instead of spending on this kind of a toilet building on other various aspects which may have social impact. But to develop your own skill, we must pursue industry to spend from their CSR and instead of depending on the government, that government will skill and then we will take the people. I think this kind of a model will work. This is my personal opinion. Thank you.
Thank you. So, Mr. Bhargav, you know, one question that we always talk about is compliance. So, if you are able to maybe in a couple of minutes tell us, with PF being online, how has it impacted our industry? You know.
The best thing which has happened is, after going online, PF officers have stopped coming to the office. because they can see what we are doing sitting in their office. So I think that's the best thing which has happened. And doing a PF compliance, yes, various regulatory things have been coming and they have been, you know, so more and more compliance has become important. And per se, I feel that that's where a staffing company's role is there. That is the USP of a staffing company, that you are a compliant company. And today, to say that you are a compliant company, the client has not to go anywhere. He can also log into the PF website and see how compliant you are. So if you, that way, if you look at it, I think it's very good for the staffing company that digitization of PF, ESIC is happening.
Great. In the interest of time, because I've been given very, very strict instructions to keep it really, really short, I think it was a good interactive session, and our objective was to give everybody a perspective of what should we keep in mind for the future in terms of things like sourcing, funding, compliance, so that we are able to capitalize on the opportunity. Also, the reason for the exercise was not just an icebreaker, but also for us to feel proud, because often we forget the business that we're in of, you know, giving jobs and careers to people. And we all know that every job impacts at least 4 to 5 people. So it's something that we should be very proud about and happy. I'm sure everybody is in this room. I don't think anybody should have any gloom and doom, as we heard earlier, where, you know, we should not feel that. I think the opportunity is there. We are all, geared up. If you have any questions for the audience, please feel free to reach us. I think we have a few minutes, Suchita. Oh. Yeah.
I want to add something positive. Clearly, the role of permanent employee versus staffing employee, the equation is going to change. 100% companies will start focusing on staffing employee, because all statistics are showing America, they are talking about 9% of the total workforce will be permanent. In our own company, TMI, we have more than about 1,100, 1,200 people working for us. Out of that, only 400 employees, 350 employees are permanent. They're not staffing. Rest of them are gig workers, part-time workers. We have pay-per-use, all kind of models. So the interesting part is that this is the time ever where the companies are going to recognize the staffing companies are important. They're doing something valuable to them, but we have to capitalize on that.
Great. So we're open for questions, if any. Suchita, do we get a prize for saving like 9 minutes? Suchita, do we get a prize? Thank you.